Good morning, church. Father God, I thank you for your word, Lord. I thank you for scripture that's been breathed by you, Father, that we have access to your voice, God. I thank you for your presence in this place and within us. I pray that we would be more aware of it, Father, in this new year, God, by your grace. That we would be devoted to your word, Father, devoted to fellowship, devoted to communion, and devoted to prayer, Father. In your name we pray, amen. Let everything
At the mercy seat, now I've tasted It's not hard to see, only you can satisfy. There's honey in the rock, there's honey in the rock, there's honey in the rock, there's honey in the rock.
There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit, you
tasted and seen. My shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come find this place and feel the atmosphere. Your myself. Praise me to God, praise me to God. A new life I've been dealt. Sing it. Never look back, no, I can't go back. I'm yours. I never look back, no, I can't go back. I'm yours. Come on.
Praise me to God, praise me to God, praise me to God. You saved me from myself. Praise me to God.
Praise me to God, praise me to God, praise me to God.
Praise be to God, praise be to God. A new life I've been dealt. Never look back, no, I can't go back. I'm yours. I never look back, no, I can't go back. I'm yours. Holy Spirit, make me more like Jesus. Every day a little. Crucify my flesh, that my new life might be secure. Everything I do, done so I can honor you. Resurrect me, sanctify, make me more like you. Holy Spirit, make me more like you. Every day of with yours, so my new life might be secure. Everything I do, done so I can honor you. Resurrect me, sanctify, make me into your image.
Thing that he studied, God, yes, for God. Such a
bless you, Jesus. Lift your hands in this place. If you want to be more like Jesus, you need a little bit more Jesus. We need a lot more Jesus. Bless you, Lord. Fill us up, Jesus. Less of us, more of you, Jesus. We bless you this morning. We abandon ourselves. We lean into you. Let what we say, what we do, how we act, how we respond, let everything be a reflection of you and your glory. We love you this morning, Jesus. We love you this morning, Jesus. Yes. Holy Spirit, make me more like Jesus.
Holy Spirit, make me more like Jesus. Every day a little more like Jesus. Crucify my flesh with yours, that my new life might be secure. Everything I do, done so I can honor you. Resurrect me, sanctify, make me more.
you, Holy Spirit, make me more like Jesus. Every day a little more like Jesus. Crucify my flesh with yours, then my new life might be secure. Everything I do, done so I can honor you. Resurrect me, sanctify me, make me into your image.
Bless you, God. Yes. You may be seated for a time of communion this morning. Mm. 2023 coming to a close today. You know, I've had some of the most incredible things happen to me in my life this year. And I've also had some crappy things happen this year. And probably in this room, that's your story. I would imagine with as many people in here, some really good things and some not so good things probably. But as we near out the end of the year, this is the time of year where we start to think about new beginnings. We start to think about fresh starts. I can't think of a better new beginning than when a person gives their life to Jesus Christ and starts their new life with Him. And I tell you, you know, I've got some things on the list of new beginnings, new things I want to try for 2024. But man, I'll tell you, my track record of starting new things, maybe through the end of January, February. But here's the thing when it comes to our new, fresh start, new beginning in Christ Jesus. It's not on us. It's not in our strength. It's all in His strength. And so when we fail and when we trip up and when we're not consistent, when we're not faithful, we get to lean on Him because it's His strength that we were leaning on in the first place. And here's the thing. We are called to die to ourselves daily. We don't just choose Christ once and boy, I hope we make it the rest of the time. No, we're supposed to die daily. So this fresh start mentality is something that we're commissioned to have every single day. Every single day. And because it's not on us in our own strength, we can lean into Him and we can trust that we're going to make it. That we can be strong. That we can have the strength to get up and carry our cross because it's on Him. It's on Him. And had He not done what He did on the cross, and had He not been resurrected and alive today, well, we wouldn't be able to lean into the strength of Christ Jesus. As I need new life every single day. I need a fresh start every single day. And as we come to the table this morning, we want to remember the sacrifice that Jesus made for us. The death, the grueling death that He paid on a cross because of our sin, because of our failures and our trip-ups and our unfaithfulness. But man, He makes us whole. He takes our broken places, our broken pieces, and He makes something so beautiful. When you come to the table, let's remember it's not about us at all. But boy, it's totally about Him, and I'm so glad. If you're going to serve at the table this morning, would you come and get in your places? Would you guys stand with me? We're going to pray. Father, I thank You, Lord, for the great gift of Jesus. I thank You, Lord, for the strength that You give us and You render to us every day, that it's not on us, but it's on You. And so in our weakness, we're made strong because of You. And today we remember what You did, the choice that You made in being obedient to Your Father, so that we might have a relationship with You. We love You this morning. We thank You for this bread and this cup in Jesus' name. Amen. You are released to receive communion this morning.
My oxygen, my very breath, the source of life, the source of rest. fragile cells, you carry me through crashing waves. Oh, I need you. Breathing you in, Yahweh, Yahweh. Without your word, so be the spark, Lord, let me burn. Oh, I need you. Oh, I need you. Burning within, Yahweh, Yahweh. The great I am. You are the great I am, seated upon the throne. Nothing can take your place in my heart. I'm bringing all I am, standing with lifted hands. Nothing can take your place in my heart. Singing your name, singing your name, Yahweh, Yahweh.
Singing your name,
Yahweh, Yahweh.
Church, you may be seated this morning for a time of tithes and offering.
Good morning, church. As we prepare for tithes and offerings, I was just praying this morning about what to speak to y'all about and what to the message to deliver to y'all. And I just felt like God was telling me to go to 2 Corinthians 8. So it's 8, 1 through 15. It says, "And now, brothers and sisters, we want you to know about the grace that God has given to the Macedonian churches. In the midst of a very severe trial, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity. For I testify that they gave as much as they were able and even beyond their ability. Entirely on their own, they urgently pleaded with us for the privilege of sharing in this service to the Lord's people, and they exceeded our expectations. They gave themselves first of all to the Lord," remember that, first of all to the Lord, "and then by the will of God also to us. So we urge Titus, just as he had earlier made a beginning, to bring also to the completion this act of grace on your part. But since you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness, and in the love we have kindled in you, see that you also excel in his grace of giving. I am not commanding you, but I want to test the sincerity of your love by comparing it with the earnestness of others. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you, through his poverty, might become rich. And here is my judgment about what is best for you in this matter. Last year, you were the first not only to give, but also to have the desire to do so. Now finish the work so that your eager willingness to do so or do it may be matched by your completion of it according to your means. For if the willingness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one does not have. Our desire is not that others might be relieved while you are working and hard-pressed, but that there might be equality. At the present time, your plenty will supply what they need, so that in turn, their plenty will supply what you need. The goal is equality. As it is written, the one who gathered much did not have too much, and the one who gathered little did not have too little." This really just spoke to me because God loves us so much that he gave everything. He had the entire universe, and he came down here and became poor for us. He gave everything he had because he loved us so much. Think about all the stuff that we have compared to the rest of the world. We have so much. And yet sometimes we hold on to it with everything we have. And we're like, no, I've got this. I'm holding on to it. But God wants us to love abundantly and even past that. He wants us to give everything to him first and then to others. We are called to love each other generously. And we are supposed to show grace in this way. So give what you feel God is telling you to. This is not us telling you, hey, we need your money, but when you bless the church with this, we are able to bless others. That is the whole point of it. It is not just paying bills. It is blessing and giving that grace to others that sometimes can't take care of themselves. And in turn, God blesses you. So right now we have people that are going to be passing around these baskets, and you can place the money in there. And we also have baskets on the edge of the stage to give to others that are less fortunate. And there's also a QR code up there if you need to use that. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for taking care of us in every way. Thank you for allowing us the ability to bless others. Even when we have nothing, we can still give our love and our time. Thank you, Jesus, for that. Help us to always give earnestly and generously, because we love you and we give ourselves to you first and then to others, Lord. Help us to remember that in Jesus' name. Amen.
As you are coming to give, just turn to somebody next to you and say, I'm glad you're here this morning. Did you guys get my stuff? Are we good? Okay. Well, I have a number of things to convey to you this morning, so I'm going to try to do this in an expedient fashion because I want to get to the word. First of all, we are going to return to normal, whatever that means, pretty soon here. We will not have a midweek gathering this Thursday, but we will be having a Sunday gathering next week at our regular time. So we will start back at 9 and at 10:30. I want to encourage you, we've been talking about already about new beginnings and stuff. I want to encourage you that if you've been coming to this gathering, and want an extra opportunity to connect with the community here in the body, we have a Sunday morning class called The 12 that meets over in the Fellowship Hall. And during this little break, we've actually done some renovation to the Fellowship Hall, so it is almost complete, and we'll be ready for the class next week over there. But that starts at 9 o'clock. The 12, bring your Bible and come and be a part of that. It's a real rich time in the Word, and then you can just come right into the service here at 10:30. So we want to encourage you to do that. And then that following Thursday, we are going to start a new series called Seeking Jesus. And Pastor Wayne Berry is going to be leading this series. And you're not going to want to miss it. So that's going to start on January 11th, Thursday night, 6 to 7 p.m. There will be youth and kids ministry available. The youth junior high meet from 6 to 7, and then the senior high meets after that, 7 to 8:30. So come and be a part of that. The kids ministry will be doing junior Bible quiz starting that week as well. So come and be a part of our midweek gatherings, January 11th. That's going to be a great series. Something else I want to put on your radar that's real important to me, and I really want you all to mark your calendars and be a part of this, okay? The last three Sundays in January, we are going to have vision casting gatherings, okay? That will be on January 14th, the 21st, and the 28th. What we're going to do is at 5 o'clock, we're going to have a potluck dinner for everybody in the fellowship hall, okay? Next week, we'll give some more details about that. So we're going to eat together and fellowship together, and then we're going to come in here for a gathering from 6 to 7:15 p.m., and you are going to hear some of the vision that we have for 2024 for Springhouse Church in general. You're going to hear from the various ministries. You're going to hear from some of the leadership, and I'm going to share my heart about where we're going for 2024. So I want you to mark your calendars and be a part of this. We're going to worship together. It's going to be a great time, and if you want to be in on the know, if you want to be on the inside track of what we're doing here at Springhouse, I want you to be here. Kids ministry is going to be full blown force. They're going to do a whole service for the kids each of those nights. The youth ministry is going to be doing youth gatherings those nights, and the preschool hallway is going to be open. They're actually going to be doing cool church and all of the things that they typically do on Sunday mornings. They're going to be doing on Sunday evenings with a little bit of a pop too. Sherry was telling me last night some ideas that she has, so it's going to be real great for the kids and for the youth as well. So we want the family, church family, to be here on those evenings in January so we can hear about what the Lord has for us for 2024. Does that sound good? So mark your calendars, be here. We're going to eat because we like to eat. And then we're going to worship the Lord together, okay? So those are on those nights. Okay, on your chair this morning, you received a Bible reading plan, okay? This is, I want you to consider this more than a suggestion, okay? We as a church body, we're going to read through the New Testament this year together, okay? So this is something that we're going to do together. And what I love about this particular reading plan, guys, is there are literal times and moments when, just quite frankly, you don't get to it in the day. Is that true? Is that fair? Okay. But this Bible reading plan, if you'll stick to it, it allows you to have 2 days where you missed it in the week, okay? This is 5 days, 5 of the 7 days that you commit to reading through the New Testament. And we want to walk through this together, okay? So if you'll take that Bible reading plan with you, we're going to post it in our app and on the website as well, so you have access to it digitally. But this is a great tool to use. You'll be in tandem with everybody. And guys, there's nothing like seeing the Holy Spirit move when we're reading something together and we experience something and we say, hey, that's what I just read together in Scripture. The Lord can do some real incredible things with that. So take this. Tomorrow's the first. So starting tomorrow, this coming week, we will read through those first five passages. So lock into this, commit to this. Let's do this as a body and encourage each other and spur each other on with that. Okay, does that sound good? All right, this year, 2024, where we're going, we're going to be looking at His Word, His life, and His church. Okay, that's what we're looking at in 2024. I'm excited about the direction the Lord has, is going to be taking us. Now, traditionally, this Sunday would have been Read the Word Sunday. And if you've been here for any length of time, every year we just really look to encourage and inspire and really motivate the congregation to be in the Word. And I hope that happens today. I want you to be in the Word. I think being in the Word is essential for every believer, to be in the Word and growing in the Word daily, okay? But what we're going to do is we're actually going to expand this this portion of our series into 5 weeks. His Word, we're going to be talking about this for the next 5 weeks. And we might, what I want to do, where my heart was, is I want to uncover maybe some questions that maybe you've considered or maybe questions that you've not considered before. Go ahead and put up that first one. So here's some questions we're going to be uncovering and looking at over the next 5 weeks. Why do Christians believe His Word holds authority over their lives, and what fruit comes from doing what it says? Next. Why is it important to have a daily, active relationship with His Word, and how does it apply to everyday life? Next. How is His Word relevant and useful in our culture, and what does it tell us about the future? Okay, next. Why is it important to know His Word in your mind and carry it in your heart? Well, here's 4 questions, and then today we're going to be looking at, where did the Bible even come from? Who wrote it? And why has it stood the test of time? So that's going to be our kickoff for today in His Word. And Pastor Justin's going to be the word, bring the word this morning. Would you welcome him?
Thank you so much, Pastor. If I can go ahead and get the worship team, come on back out. We'll just close this out today. Kidding. Relax. My stuff. I got a lot of stuff today. Bet your Bible don't look like that. Let me get my other Bible out too.
Give me just a second.
These are not props. This is not like a magic show or anything. Like, this is what I'm actually using. Like, don't think this is just like stuff. And this, look, guys, I'm growing. I'm working on myself. I'm trying to get better, okay? So, like, I always have the weirdest water bottle up here. So, but I'm not buying the $45 metal one that's trendy right now with the rubber straw. I'm not buying that. And then if I come up here with my gym shaker cup, I feel like a gym bro. Or if I have the little crunchy water bottle, that's bad too. And then I bring this mason jar with clear liquid in it, and then somebody's like, oh, okay, bud. And depending on how this message goes, you'll know what was in it by the end of the sermon today, if it's water or not. 2023, look, all bets are off, okay? I'm going to end this year out. Great. Okay, actual Bible stuff. So have you guys ever wondered, like, how did we get the Bible? Who wrote it? Where did it come from? Or if men wrote it, how can we be sure it's God's Word? Any number of questions like this can be legitimately asked when it comes to the Bible. And today, as we begin our series on His Word, we're going to look at the history of God's Word, its origins, its roots, and why it has stood the test of time. If you could go ahead and put the first slide up, and then I'll do the next ones. Okay? If you would stand with me, if you're able, and we're going to read this passage, and then we'll get into the word today. Are we ready? Bless you. Here we go. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And no creature is hidden from his sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that it is alive and active and that it does cut us in order to heal us, Lord God. I pray today as we look at your word that you would quicken us in our hearts, it would become alive to us, that we would see your goodness and your mercy and your son Jesus through its pages. God, we love you and we thank you. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen and amen. You guys can be seated. So I'm going to give you a little bit of a caveat first before we start. The Bible is commonly referred to as the Word of God, and it's true. However, the Word of God predates the Bible, especially in its current form. John 1, does my thing work? All right, you can do it for me. If you put the next passage up, John 1:1-3 says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made." John 1 echoes here the opening line of Genesis that says, "In the beginning, God created." And this is an echo of that. The Greek word logos for the word conveys the idea of divine self-expression or speech. There's a few things I want you to understand about God's word. God's word is effective. He speaks things into existence. God's word speaks things into existence. Genesis 1:3. Let's look at this. It says, "And God said, let there be light, and there was light." Psalm 33:6. It says, "By the word of the Lord, the heavens were made, and by the breath of his mouth, all their hosts." If you've heard Pastor Kevin talk about a star-breathing God, this is exactly where he got that from. He spoke stars into existence. You want to talk about some raw power and energy there, okay? And then Psalm 107:20, "He sent out his word and healed them and delivered them from their destruction." I've told you guys about Renewed Life Ministries, which is a one-year discipleship program for men with life-controlling problems that I was an attendant and resident of, right? This was their founding verse. This is a one-year recovery program, and it was founded on the belief that God's word is able to heal men and deliver them from their addictions. It's not going to be your programming. It's not going to be your community. All those are fantastic tools that will help you along the way, but it's God's word that heals us and delivers us from destructive patterns of life. Isaiah 55:10-11. It says, "For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return there, but water the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose and shall succeed in the thing for which I sent it." God speaks things into existence. His word is effective. And this is also how he relates to his people. Genesis 15:1. It says, "After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Fear not, Abram, I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great." God has chosen his word to communicate with his people. Simply, there is a difference between the Bible and God's word. But since the Bible is how we know that there's a difference, that means the Bible is God's word. Does that make sense? Whatever, moving along. It's just a caveat. I just want you to understand there's a difference between God's word and the Bible, but the Bible is God's word, okay? Moving along. I'm just going to leave that off there, okay? Okay, let me start by saying this is an ancient book. This is a very, very ancient and old book. If its pages and binding were as old as the content that was written therein, I believe we would have a greater reverence and awe for the scriptures. He probably wouldn't collect as much dust on nightstands or be tucked nicely away in hotel drawers. There would be a reverence. Okay, if you had a Pepsi bottle, a plastic Pepsi bottle with hieroglyphics printed on it, or if you had a stone tablet with hieroglyphics carved into it, which one do you think you would treat with more respect? Right? But yet, we have a plastic bottle with hieroglyphics printed on it that we throw in the drawer. If it was in its form that it was originally created in, we would be a lot more hype about the scriptures. Secondly, God is the source of all the information in the Bible, okay? 2 Timothy 3:16 through 17 says, all scripture, all of it, is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction. We don't like that one. And for training in righteousness, that the man or woman of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. I'm not adding things to the scriptures. That phrase, that the man of God may complete, it might as well be translated as the person. The person of God, the God-fearing, God-following person will be equipped for every good work. Does that make sense? All right, is that an upward nod, James? Is that a, okay. The Bible in its current form, this codex here, was written by over 35 people over a period of 1,500 years. It's a long time. Our codex contains 66 books, 39 in the Old Testament, 27 in the New Testament. It contains history, poetry, wisdom writings, prophecy, parables, teachings, love songs, worship directives, raising your hands, laws and sacrifices, beauty, sin, death, and eyewitness testimony. There is not a more complete book on this planet. We're a blessed people to have access to the revealed character and will of God in such a complete form. Throughout history, not everyone has had access to this word. And I'm not talking about third world countries, or I'm not talking about communist regimes. I'm talking about this complete codex, the time in which we are living to have all of these scriptures at this time. We are a very blessed people because we have God's revealed heart and will for our lives and how we are operating in a kingdom here on earth. Amen? So, is this the Bible that Jesus read? No. And you'd be like, well, duh. He's what the New Testament's all about. No, that's not what I'm talking about, okay? I say, actually, nay, the whole Bible is about Jesus. Do you guys remember Kevin's skit that he had come out? When I say Kevin, anything that's on the church that I remember, I'm like, it's Kevin's. That way you can never get mad at me unless it's like something like this. But do you remember Kevin's skit where he had the kids come out and they're like, in Job, he's this, and in Nehemiah, he's that. Look, I don't even remember. That's how bad it was, right? No, I got one. Look, he was like, in Jeremiah, he's the weeping prophet. In Ruth, he's our kinsman redeemer. You guys remember that, right? And they go through the whole Bible. And in Revelation, he's our coming king, right? That's actually a thing. It's called a scarlet thread, and you can weave and see Jesus in every single aspect of the scriptures. That scripture we read at the beginning, John 1:1, that's actually about Jesus, because if you read the passage, John goes on to tell you, I'm talking about Jesus. He's preeminent. He predates all of this nonsense. Everything was created by him, for him, and through him. It's a real thing. You can trace Jesus through the entire Bible. But in all seriousness, the Hebrew scriptures that Jesus and the apostles read consisted of a three-part collection called the Tanakh. Can you put that up there, please? Oh, geez, why did I send this? My bad, y'all. Okay? You can see Tanakh, and you can search that on your smartphone later on. But the Tanakh actually consists of three parts, the Torah, the T-A-T-O-R-A. It's T-A right there. All you English professors out there. So the Torah, the Nevi'im, and the Ketuvim, okay? This is the Torah, the prophets, and the writings. And this was the structure that a lot of scholars believe that the Hebrew Bible was written in. And there's actually a lot of contemporaries of Jesus and Jesus that allude to this order in the scriptures. In Luke chapter 24, verse 44, this is what Jesus says. If you can put that up for me. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the Torah, the prophets, and the Psalms or the writings must be fulfilled." So Jesus' explanation gives a layout of this pattern according to the Hebrew Bible. And he takes it a step further in Luke chapter 11, verse 51. This is part of a bigger phrase that Jesus is saying. I'm not cherry picking. I'm just getting to the point here, okay? It says, "From the blood of Abel to the blood of Zechariah, who perished between the altar and the sanctuary, yes, I tell you, it will be required of this generation." So why would Jesus say from Abel to Zechariah? Well, Zechariah is actually the last prophet that's mentioned being martyred in the book of Chronicles. Well, according to our codex, Chronicles is smack dab in the middle, okay? But in the Hebrew Bible, Abel is in the beginning in Genesis, and Zechariah is at the end in Chronicles, and Jesus is saying, from this one in the beginning to this one in the end, this blood shall be required of you. So Jesus is alluding to this format in the scriptures. This is important, okay? In the Tanakh, Chronicles is the last book. He's referring to all of the martyrs. It doesn't make sense for us because Chronicles is in the middle of the Bible. Now, I know you're probably wondering, well, how did it get split up in our Bible and why? That's a legit question. And you're not going to like the answer. I have no idea. I have no idea, right? And you know why? Because there's no unanimous decision. The Bible doesn't tell you this is the order that it needs to be in, right? Right? It's most likely, there's a couple of, like, theories. Like, it could be that over time they drifted from, like, Jewish tradition the more that the New Testament church advanced away from its Jewish roots. That's one possibility. Another possibility is that somebody just got a wild hair and was like, "We're changing this up. I don't like the order. Do y'all want to do that too?" And they're like, "Sure, whatever." I don't know. So any number of these theories could be legitimate. Speaking of reading and how Jesus would have read, have you ever heard of the triennial reading tradition? Of course you've never heard of the triennial reading tradition. That was a trick question, Jeremy. This is great. Of course you haven't. This is fantastic, okay? You're going to love this, okay? Because remember the Tanakh. I know that tiny PDF that I had up there was only up there for 13 seconds. But just remember the order. Torah, right? Then the prophets, then the writings, okay? This is the triennial reading tradition, and this is very cool. Every Sabbath for thousands of years, synagogues in Israel and surrounding areas would focus their readings on the Torah and the prophets. You can actually see this in Acts 13, 15. When they go to the council, they first read the Torah, and then they do a reading out of the prophets. And so here's what they would do. They spread out their Bible plan over 3.5 years. Pastor Kevin has thought that we'll just do the New Testament in 1 year. Well, they did the Torah in 3.5. So I guess we're just going to rush through ours, right? There's no need to follow, you know, ancient biblical traditions. Why would we ever do that, you know? I'm kidding. God bless. Like, this guy's hardcore. If you're a first-time visitor, look, I am not the lead pastor. He will be back up. And, Jane, this is how we close out the new year, right? Like, you know, like, when the game's almost over and you just shovel guys out there. You know what I'm saying? And the third-string guys are like, it's my time. I'm getting a, this is kind of what that's like. It's bowl season, so they're sending out the guys that don't get a lot of playing time. This is it, okay? It's what they call garbage time, right? Hey, man, Did it, bud. Get out there. Good way to close it out, man. We're already ahead this year. Y'all saw the giving statement. Like, we're good. Like, we're in the black. Like, let's send Justin out there, right? So, moving along, right? Okay, so check this out. So they didn't, in this triennial reading tradition in these synagogues, they didn't have a single leader that preached every week, kind of like us, right? We don't have, like Pastor Kevin has heard from the Lord that there is anointed teaching in this house, and he gives a platform for that. Some of you guys connect with different pastors, and it's all the same word that goes forth, which is God's word, and it somehow weaves together, okay? But that's actually biblical, because they would have different speakers that would come up and read. Each week, instead of a single pastor, an adult member would be invited to read the sections of scripture in the Torah, and then they would pick a prophetic passage that corresponds with the Torah reading. So imagine this, they would bring them the scroll, and they had a Bible plan that they were reading, okay? And every week they would read a different passage out of the Torah over 3.5 years as they worked through it. Are you following me? Okay, so I don't know what week they would have been on, but they would have all been on the same week. Then the person that's the volunteer would read the passage. Then they would pick a prophecy or a prophetic passage that would correspond or elaborate with the passage out of the Torah. Are you tracking? Okay. So this is what we give you. Then you pick one, and they should go along with one another. Okay. This prophetic passage reading was called the Haftarah, meaning completion. It gave you a complete picture of God's word. God, the Torah and the prophecy were all weaving and worked together. Now, in Luke chapter 4, verse 16 through 30, Jesus is in the temple, and he gets selected to read these passages. Now, Luke doesn't record the passage in the Torah, but we know according to their tradition, he most likely would have read a Torah passage and then read this prophetic passage. So Jesus, of all the people they could have picked this day, right? They picked Jesus Christ to stand up and read the scroll. Okay? So Jesus gets the scroll, and then he reads this passage out of Isaiah 61. Put this up there. What are the odds of this? Right? Scroll. Unroll the scroll. I don't know which way they would have read it, but the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to those who are bound, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn. And then in the ultimate mic drop moment, he rolls this scroll up. This is what it says in the Bible. He rolls it up, hands it back to them, and is like, today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. And they lose their mind. Right? They tried to run him out. Look, depending what's in this. Look, they lost their mind, but how beautiful is this, that they had already had a Bible plan laid out long before he got there. Then the day he goes in the temple, he just so happens to get selected to read, and then he reads a passage that corresponds with the Torah, and the passage that corresponds with his Torah reading is a prophecy that he fulfills in the synagogue. Is it not? Am I the only one hype about this? Like, I'm not asking you to be over the top like me. My wife's like, okay, well, how does this apply to my life? I'm like, no, babe, you gotta understand. This is wild stuff, right? This stuff don't just happen. This stuff doesn't just happen. And they flip out, and they try to run him out of the church, and he's like, it's too late. This prophecy is fulfilled right here in your hearing. It's too late. This prophecy is fulfilled. It's done. It's over with. Moving along. So I want you to understand, the Bible that we read was not the original scriptures or the layout that the early apostles or Jesus or the early Jews would have even read. This is something completely different. This is a more complete version than what they had. We are a blessed people. So where did our Bible come from? Where did our Bible come from? The term canon
is used to describe the books that are divinely inspired and therefore belong in the Bible. The problem or difficulty is that the Bible does not give us a list of what books are supposed to be in the Bible. Wouldn't that be nice if the Bible was like, hey, here's the order, lay it out like this. Unfortunately, that's not the case. We don't have that. But ultimately, I believe that if God can inspire the words of the books and scrolls that were to be written, I have to believe that he can inspire the ones that were in charge to put it together of what to put in there. I highly doubt this nefarious plot from the enemy to hide books from you and put books in the Bible. These councils acknowledge the Apocrypha and a lot of these other ancient texts, but I believe that a holy God that is sovereign enough to speak things to existence and give man his word is sovereign enough to know what books we need to put in there. That's what I believe. That's what I believe. So what they did was the early churches came together in these councils. We're talking about post-Christ, post-resurrection, early church, 200-400 year AD range. The Council of Laodicea in AD 364 featured about 30 people. These were members from local churches in the Middle East, and they produced 60 rulings, okay? And these rulings or canons covered various church-related topics. So it would be like, what books are we going to read? What letters are we going to allow read in churches or different things that they're going to do in there? The 59th ruling of these 60 declared that only the canonical, is that the right way to say that? Only the books that were canonized would be read in churches, okay? Only the books that were canonized would be read in churches. That was number 59. Number 60 specified that the books that were going to read were the traditional 26 books of the New Testament and the 39 books of the Old Testament. For some reason, they read Revelation, put it completely out of there. It was like, we're not putting that in there. Have you read Revelation? You will this year. And I'll be back next year at the end of the year, and we'll talk about the end times, okay, guys? I'm going to have slides. We have pictures of angels up there. It's going to be wild. Something to look forward to. We're building. We're building here, right? So they specified as traditional 26 books of the New Testament minus Revelation and 39 of the Old Testament. They also treated the Apocrypha. There are 14 books that are referred to as the Apocrypha that are not unbiblical, they're extra-biblical. Does that make sense? They're not unbiblical, they're extra-biblical. And they determined that these books were useful and even sacred, but not inspired, and ultimately they were a separate category from the traditional canon. Okay, the early church at these councils didn't say, hey, we should do away with these books. They said, no, these aren't the books that are supposed to be in here. The Old Testament books and writings were pretty much a no-brainer. Pretty much, right, that was passed down from their Jewish heritage, these 39 books of the Old Testament, even if the order was a little bit wonky. If you remember that brief moment that I had the slide up, the prophets and the writings, they grouped together separately. So basically, we've expounded that. So instead of Kings, it's 1 and 2 Kings. Instead of Samuel, it's 1 and 2. So we got extra books by separating it. Does that make sense? Okay. The New Testament books required a lot more debate. When they came together for these councils, they had a lot more debate over these books. Specifically, the books that were in question were Hebrews, James, 2 Peter, 2 and 3 John. And I completely agree. Have you ever read the book of James? You will this year. Matter of fact, we'll get a jump start on that. Look at this, James 1. Look, this is all in the first chapter. This will ruin your life. I stopped reading James. I'm not reading it again until we get there. Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. All right, page 1, right at the top. Look, verse 2. Hey, guys, welcome to James. Listen, stop tripping. It's a blessing that you're going through trials. Look, next one. Look, What's the next one? Verse 120. For the anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. Go ahead to the next one, 26. What does this say? If anyone thinks he's religious and does... I'm not reading that. This is why they was like, we cannot put this book in here. We're going to be held to this standard if we do this, right? If anyone thinks he's religious and does not bridle his tongue, he deceives his heart, and this person's religion is worthless. This is the first chapter of the first five chapters in this book. Five. That's actually not why they didn't want to include it, okay? This is just me carrying on because we don't want to read Romans. We'd rather sit down in Psalms and sing happy thoughts to ourselves instead of allowing the Word of God to cut and pierce and penetrate and divide soul and spirit and say, look, you're living your life like this, but this is the way you need to be living. No, we'd rather be comforted in these cush passages. The Lord is for me. The Lord is my fortress. Yeah, he is all that, but he's also the one that says, shape it up, son. Get up, we got a wedding to go to. How do I know that? That's what the Word says. So stop wrestling around in your wedding clothes, making a mess. You ever been somewhere nice with your kid? Who got kids, right? You ever get dressed up to go somewhere nice, and you look and they're wrestling in the front yard like, what are you doing? Like, we not even got to church yet, and you got grass stains on your pants. All right, we're going to take pictures, and your hair's all messed up, and your collar's doing this, right? That's us. God's like, get up out of the dirt, rolling around. How do I know I'm rolling in the dirt? Look, you laugh. That's how I know. Oh, that's me. That's me. That's you. Oh, gosh. And then he goes back to that verse in Hebrews. The Word of God is alive. It is alive. It is a rhema word. That means this word is active. It is living. It is God-breathed, okay? God spoke this word into existence, but this word has power to it. It's alive and active and sharper than any two-edged sword. Sometimes, have you ever cut yourself and it was so sharp you didn't even know you were cut until you looked down and you're bleeding? Right? Sometimes I'll read the Bible and don't even know I'm messed up until about noon when something happened. I was like, oh, I'm doing it. No. Right? Gave my kid a warning last night. I said, listen, we go to cool church. Don't you be asking nobody for nothing. You ain't getting no Bible books. You ain't taking no Bible books. Matter of fact, don't even say the word Bible books. If you think about Bible books, I'll know when you're going to owe me Bible books. Right? Gave him this whole speech, this whole warning, right? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Right? But he's been doing things to get Bible bucks. And I'm like, I see what you're doing. So then we had a little episode at dinner, right? And he had this whole plan devised in his head. I'm going to ask Dad if I can get some gum after dinner. And then I know what kind of person my brother is. He's a kind person, and he really has the gum that I want. So I'm gonna ask Dad if we can get gum, and then I'm gonna ask brother if I can get some of his gum, and then I get to keep my gum, get the gum I want, and we all win, and I got gum. Of course, you know Dad ain't stupid, right? I see what you're doing. This is church training for Bible bucks. Follow me where I'm going, right? I was able to show him, based on the conversation we had just had, that this type of mentality and thinking is how this right here happens. I was able to speak the word ahead of time so that when he got in the situation, he would hopefully remember the word that had been told to him and avoid those manipulative motives and ways of living and acting. That is what the Word of God does in our life. Why? Because it's alive. It is an active word, and God knows what we need before we need it. And sometimes you'll have Bible verses. That's why I tell my kids, just put something in the bucket. Put some water in the bucket, right? Why do I got to read these Old Testament passages? I don't even understand half these names. Put it in there, and the Holy Spirit will get it out when you need it. But if you run around with an empty bucket because you only like reading Psalms, that ain't what you need when it all goes down. Or as Pastor Kevin likes to say, when it gets real crappy, okay? Right? When it gets crappy, you might not need a psalm. You might need hey, shut your mouth, son, because you're going to make yourself, it's going to make it worse. Anybody married? Is anybody a child in here? Where was I at? Moving along. So they didn't want to put James in there. I said all that to say this. They didn't want to put James in there, and I get it. But the council, they followed something similar to this in their guidelines. These were something along these lines were their guidelines on what books do we put in here, okay? Was the author an apostle of Jesus or had a close connection to one of the apostles? Is the book being accepted or bear witness with the body at large? Are there large groups of the body that are receiving these letters and they're going, man, I don't know, this don't sound right. Or are these letters that are actually being accepted by the body? Number three, does it contain consistency of doctrine and orthodoxy teaching? And number four, did the book bear evidence of high moral and spiritual values that reflect the work of the Holy Spirit? Does it bear evidence of high moral spiritual values that reflect the work of the Holy Spirit? Again, God is the one who inspired and determined what belongs in the Holy Scriptures. And you'll be happy to know that the Council of Hippo in AD 393 and the Council of Carthage in AD 397 added the book of Revelation and affirmed all of these books as authoritative, just in case you were wondering how we ended up with Revelation. They had a couple more councils later on and said, all 26 we affirm, but we also affirm Revelation. So now we have what I refer to as the Codex. This is our Codex for living. We have all 39 books of the Old Testament. Regardless of the order, the content is the same, and we have them. And then we have 27 letters and books of the New Testament that complete this holy word of God, our codex, our holy Bible. But what is the purpose? What is the purpose of the Bible? Although there's many reasons, some that are known and revealed to us in the Word, and some of these are a mystery, but there's two main reasons I want to focus on. There's two main reasons as we close out this message and we begin our journey through 2024. I want these two reasons to stick with you of why I think that are the most important reasons that God has given us the Bible. Number one, that we might have hope. God has given us the word that we might have hope. Romans 15:4 says, for whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, that through endurance and through the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. That's biblical, that the God said, I have given you these scriptures so that you will be a people that has hope. Hope, and not hope in this world, but hope in what's to come, that one day he's going to make it all right. Paul writes in, I believe it's in Romans, or no, it's in Corinthians, he says, if my hope is in this world alone, I am of all men most miserable. If my hope is just here, I'm the most miserable person on the planet. The Word of God acts like God himself. It reveals his nature and love for us. It lays out his plan for redemption, and it carries us through this world. The revelation of this love and hope is through the second purpose, which I believe the second and most important reason why we have the Bible is to introduce us to Jesus Christ. It's all about him. This word introduces us to Jesus Christ. Hebrews chapter 1. Long ago, at many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom also he created the world. He is the radiance of the glory of God in the exact imprint of his nature, and he upholds the universe by the word of his power. After making purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high, having become as much superior to angels as the same name he has inherited, more excellent than theirs. For to which of the angels did God ever say, you are my son, today I have begotten you? Or again, I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. The Word of God has stood the test of time because it's outside of it. It's outside of time. It's not bound by it. God's word is eternal, according to Psalm 119:89 and Isaiah 40, chapter 40, verse 8, and Matthew 24:35. His eternal word is outside of space and time, because he is outside of space and time. His eternal word has revealed to us his son, Jesus Christ. He's our high priest who intercedes on our behalf. The lamb slain before the foundation of the world. This redemption story is cover to cover, beginning to end, front to back. This is our redemption story. That means I'm included in this. I'm included in this ancient book. Why? Because I know that God sent his son for me. Therefore, I'm included in his pages. What other book has the ability to do that? I know some of us are avid, vigorous readers, and we have the ability to be captured by a story or drawn in, but that story's not about us. That story's about someone else or some other life. This one is not about us and is all about us at the exact same time, and I don't even know how that happens. I don't know. See, that's got nothing to do with me and everything to do with me at the exact same time. Blows my mind. That God, but it's so like him to say, look, I want you to know who I am. I want you to know what I'm like. Although this story is about David and Nathan, I want you to see yourself in his pages, because I want you to see how I love you, and I don't want you to be hiding and doing things that are wrong. But you'll learn this lesson, son. Yeah, he has the ability to do that. He has the ability to do that. Why, what good dad would I be if I don't try to teach the kid the lesson about stinking Bible, they're not stinking, about Bible bucks and chewing gum and just let him keep doing destructive and selfish things? What kind of dad would do that? So what kind of father would not want the kid to know, hey, this is what kind of person I am. This is how much I love you. This is how much I've loved people throughout history. There's some things you don't have the brain capacity to understand, and so I'm not even going to bother telling you. Maybe I'll make it known one day. Maybe he won't. But for now, he has revealed himself to his word. And I'm too lazy and squawk at a 5x5x5 New Year reading plan. God's given me his eternal word that took 1,500 years to write and put together. And I can't give 15, 20 minutes on a Monday. What's wrong with me, Justin? You are that man. Look, I'm not saying you. Whoever I pointed over here, I'm not talking about you. This is what I want you to understand, okay? God's word is eternal, and I believe the two main reasons that we have this word is to give us hope and to reveal Jesus Christ, his son, who is the one that gives us hope. So we're going to worship this God together. If you need to pray, some people are going to come down here and pray with you. If you have anything that's heavy on your heart, if you're going through a season, if you're looking for more hope in 2024, I'm going to have my elders and leaders and pastors and teachers and anyone that's been anointed and appointed to come down here and pray and lay hands. And guess what? You know the Bible says if any of you are hurting or afflicted or sick and need healing, you should come down and have elders lay hands on you, and the prayer of faith will make you whole. Didn't say you might not still hurt. You might not feel instantly better, but it says it'll make you whole. Why? Because you're placing your trust in a holy God that knows better than you and has the ability to do what you ask of him. So if you need to pray for any reason, I'm going to ask you to come down. But as we worship together, let us thank God for his word, because he has revealed his son, Jesus Christ, to us through these pages. Let's worship and pray.
My oxygen, my very, the source of life, the source of rest. Oh, I need you. You're the wind that fills these fragile cells. You carry me through crashing waves. Oh, I need you. Breathe in, you in, Yahweh, Yahweh.
God has been good to us, and he has given us his word and revealed himself to us, and we are a blessed people because of it. Raise your hand. Let me give you a blessing. May the God and Father of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ fill you with the hope contained in these pages. May he create in your heart a desire and hunger and passion for his word, and may it ultimately bring you closer to his son Jesus through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. Be blessed, Springhouse.